Yeah, it's so good to get focused on what this time's all about, you know, a time when we remember Christ coming to the earth. I was so out of it like a week ago. You know, I saw the decorations and everything, but honestly, I didn't think once about the birth of Christ, because decorations don't usually remind you of that. So I took the family and went and saw The Nativity, that movie, and man, that was good. It was just good to just focus again and go, oh, that's right. This is an amazing time of year, that what we celebrate, that God would come down and be with us. And I love the words of that song. That's why we wanted you to focus on it, of this weary world that rejoices. It's like we're just tired. We're tired of what we see day in, day out, and the pain and everything else, and the fact that Christ came and it changed everything. And for us, it's the fact that Christ is going to return one day and change everything. And I hear those words to that song, and I'm going, man, I feel that now. Like, God, I'm waiting for that moment when the sun returns again. Before I get into the message right now, a couple of items of business, you know, we just got to handle because we're a church. Let you guys know, we had an external audit. We just got done maybe 2 weeks ago. We had the church audited, and we have not had an external audit the whole 13 years we've been in existence because they're expensive. And it's like, well, I think everything's in line, so why spend the money? But it's good to do, and we had to do it for the sake of accreditation for the college anyways. But they came in, looked through all the records, audit, Cape and Krause was the name of the company, came in, checked everything out, and it was pretty amazing. They could come in a week, get all of the information because everything was laid out right. They came back, gave us a clean bill of health, said, man, you guys are doing great financially. You guys got everything accounted for. And it was just good. It was good to hear that after 13 years, you know, they could look at the records and say, nope, you guys are doing it right. And I bring that up today because this week, Shirley Lundgren, who has been running our finance department this whole 13 years, she just retired. We wanted to audit her before she retired. Where are you retiring to? You know, but it was just cool, you know, because it's really been her leadership. I mean, she's the longest employee of the church. She was here from day one, and then what a testimony to her and her faithfulness over 13 years. You know, we don't typically lift people up in the service, but I bring this up because I was reminded of how it all started when, you know, we had our first week of church, and, you know, there was no one to count the money and no one to put it anywhere, And I remember telling my wife, Lisa, the one who sang, good looking, yeah, she's good, huh? I said, you know, I think I'm going to ask her, you know. So we're at dinner one night, and she thought I already asked her. And she goes, so you're going to be doing the finances for the church? And she's like, oh, what? And I'm like, I haven't talked to her yet. Anyways, you know, it's like, yeah, hey, what do you think? You know, she goes, well, I don't know. I don't know if I can manage it. I go, as long as the church stays small, I can do it. it's just so cool, though, because she was reminding me of that. She goes, remember when I told you that? As long as the church stays small, I can handle it. And back then, we were hoping, you know, God would bring in like $1,000 a week for offering, you know, so we could keep renting the junior high. And, you know, and so he did. And, you know, but you got to understand, it went from $1,000 a week to $10,000 a week within a couple of years. And now it's at $100,000 a week. You know, so you just think about her just watching over the financing, detailing everything, and accounting for every dime at the college, the church, you know, missionaries, everything. We were just talking about that, like, aren't you just amazed at what God did? You know, you would have never dreamed that you could have pulled this off. And yet here you are, you know, and the auditors come and they're saying, wow, she did a great job. So I just wanted to, if you see Shirley, you know, thank her. Years of service here and really saved us thousands of dollars by doing it so inexpensively and doing such a good job of it. And talking about money, you know, and plus with, I'm always doing these little give to them, give to them, give to them. You know, we did that picture project, and hopefully you still have those pictures up on your wall, because the point was not to get $100. The point was I want you to, every time you see that picture, you're praying for those who are in poverty around the world, and you're loving them as much as you love yourself. I want that reminder in our homes so that we think about them. Well, with that money, you know, I tell you every once in a while, hey, we were able to do this, able to do this. This week, Children's Hunger Fund, they had a container of this, this vitamin company had donated $800,000 in children's vitamins that they wanted to send to Africa. And so it was going to cost several thousand dollars to ship this thing to Africa, and they needed some money for that. And I was like, okay, go ahead, take it out of this fund, you know, and talk to the appropriate people. And we took that out. And then they said they had another shipment of $3 million of medications and antibiotics that they wanted to send to Nicaragua, but it was going to, you know, be pricey to send it over there. And so in total this week, we gave them $21,000 so they could send about $4 million of product to Africa and Nicaragua. And it's just cool to be a part of that, isn't it? It's like, wow, that's... See, that's what I love, you know. I mean, I love knowing that we're doing these things as a church. And this is what I want to do every week next year. Every week I want to come up and go, okay, guys, this is what we did this week, you know, and just tell you, you know. And that's, I mean, what a rush. What greater thing is there to do, you know, that you know, especially in working with Children's Hunger Fund, I love them because it's not just getting the vitamins to them. It's getting the vitamins in the name of the Lord. And they work through the local churches in the areas. The local churches distribute the vitamins to the kids and tell them about the Lord. And that happens in Nicaragua, happens all around the world. And I just go, wow, what greater thing could we be doing as a church? And so that's exciting. Because everything we're learning here in James is about action, right? So I talked about two weeks ago. It's like if you just talk and you say you have faith, it doesn't mean anything. Do something. If someone's in need, care for them. Do something tangible, you know, rather than just talking about it. And here in James chapter 3, he talks about it again. He talks about, gosh, our words and how powerful they can be. And it's interesting, you know, as I preach on this, you know how God just always orchestrates everything just in his timing or whatever. And this whole message is about how you could say a few words to me today that would just devastate me. Anyone in this room has the power to do that. And you could say a few words to me that would just make my day, right? Isn't that crazy that you have that type of power? And that everyone in this room is so powerful. I could say some things to devastate you to where it would just stick in your mind for the rest of the week and just, destroy you. And I could say some things that would lead you to life and maybe even lead you to repentance. And you think, wow, out of this mouth I have that much power? And it's so interesting because, like this morning before 8:30, I had this girl just chew me out right before I walked up here. And I was like, oh, okay, I don't love God. You know, it's just, you know, and I couldn't even preach last service. You know, just like, whoa, you know. And then I'm in the lobby before this service, and a couple of you came up and just made my day. It's like, wow, okay, man, this is cool. Life's good. You know, and I'm just thinking, isn't that just amazing? It's like anyone, strangers that I don't even know, can come up and say something and totally just wreck me. And then others can say something that I've never met and then just totally make my day. And we have that ability. And that's what James is talking about here. Do you understand how powerful your words are? I remember being in high school, and the first time it hit me, I said some things to some girl. Me and my buddy were just joking around. And then a few months later, I didn't know anything had happened. A few months later, I find out that this girl went into the hospital and became bulimic on account of some things that I said. And I was like, what? But I was kidding. And you just go, man, this thing's powerful. Oh, it just killed me to think, what, I said some things that impacted her that way? And through life, finding out that some things that maybe I said in jest really destroyed someone. And we've done that. We've had it done to us. Some of us remember things that were said to us. Man, someone said something when you were a kid, and you still remember it today. It worked on you over the years, and even times when you knew it wasn't true, but it still bugs you. Man, there's times when people will say things, and you know they're wrong. Everything in your mind goes, there is no bit of truth in what you just said, and you know it, you know it, you know it, yet you walk away, and you're still ruined. And you think about it, and you lay in bed and go, why did he say that? Why did she say that? You know, and it's like, even though you know. Why? Because what comes out of this mouth is so powerful. And we're just not, we just don't think sometimes. We don't realize how much power is available to us. Anyone in this room right now could use their tongue to wreck this service. Isn't that nuts? So, Suzette, you could stand up right now and go, ah, here, look at me, and then run off the, you know, run out the door. Okay? Don't do it. Now you're thinking of, I shouldn't have put that idea in your head. But, and even though it'd be like, whoa, she's weird, and she walks out, what are you going to be thinking about the rest of the service? It's like, what was that? What was that? Who is she? Her husband's still there. He didn't even, you know, what just happened? You know, it's like, wow. So one person could say something and ruin it for everyone. You know, it's so amazing, the power of this tongue. In James chapter 3, he illustrates it this way. In verse 3, he says, when you put bits into the mouth of horses to make them obey, you can turn the whole animal. He goes, or take ships as an example. Though they're large and driven by strong winds, they're steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire. A world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person. It sets the whole course of his life on fire and is itself set on fire by hell. He says, do you understand how much power is here? That's why last week, remember what Todd preached on the verses right before this? You know, James says, hey, not many of you should be teachers. You know, because those words, you're going to be judged so strictly for your words because people are listening to you. And so he uses this illustration. He goes, you know, it's like a little bit, you know, a little bit in this horse's mouth. You got this massive, strong, powerful animal, and that little bit controls the whole thing. Or a giant ship that's blown and tossed by the wind. What turns it? This little rudder. In the same way, he goes, you as a teacher, do you realize what your tongue could do? You understand how much power that has? It's an amazing statement, and I saw it this week. I don't know if any of you guys were here 2 weeks ago, when, last time I preached, at the 11:30 service. Was anyone here at 11:30 2 weeks ago? Okay, a couple of you guys. You remember at the end of the service, there was a lady up here who was struggling, and they had to run out the door and get her wheelchair, and we kind of stopped the service. It was, you know, and she just, you know, was just struggling a little bit. And I knew her name's Irene, and so we just kind of stopped service, and I was like, hey, are you okay, you know, because everyone was paying attention to this, and she goes, all right, you know, and she starts going away, and she goes, I'm sorry, and I go, no, don't be sorry, you know what, we're concerned about you. She goes, no, I'm not sorry for that. She goes, I'm sorry, I'm going to miss the rest of the sermon. I wanted to be here. And it was just so cool. You know, everyone just, you know, had the same reaction. It's like, oh, that was cool, you know. And I went and visited her at the hospital on Wednesday because she just wasn't doing well as a cancer. And it's kind of come and gone, came back again, and talked to her on Wednesday, and things weren't looking good. And she just said, first thing, she sees my face, and she just beams. She goes, Francis, oh, she has this jersey at Pastor Francis, you know, give me a hug, you know, and she just goes, I'm overflowing right now. I am so filled with joy. She goes, I have no fear. She goes, thank you. Thank you for the church. Thank you for what's been taught, that God is everything. He's everything. I cannot wait to see him. Just had so much joy that I walked out of there and I was just beaming. You know, I was telling everyone, man, I just visited this lady in the hospital. She just made my day, you know, just a few words, just talking about how precious God is to her and how much joy she has, you know, and everything else. Last night at 5:30, she went to heaven. You know, it was right here while we were in service, you know, at the end of service, someone came to me and said, hey, that lady you're talking about in service, she went home to be with the Lord just an hour ago. I'm like, what? You know, and I was thinking about this morning, her husband was here in the front row with some other family members, and just they're like beaming and yet crying, and it's just this thought of, wow, I can never get used to this. That someone could be sitting here right now and in heaven next week, you know? And to think right now, she's right there with God and she's just experiencing joy like we've never understood here on this earth. And no more pain, no more sickness, no more death, no more worrying about things we worry about, because her faith was so real, you know? It's one thing to say, I believe that Jesus rose from the dead. It's another thing to be laying in a hospital bed and showing that you believe that Jesus rose from the dead. So much so that I don't fear. I know he rose from the grave, and so I die and I rise again. Big deal. I'm full of joy. It's one thing to say that you believe that, you know, because the Bible says you need to confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. We can all say that we believe that Jesus, you know, rose from the dead, and we believe that in our hearts. But at the end, that's when you see, okay, she really believed it. She totally believed it. And it was just so cool that those few last words, it was weird when she left here that day. It's like I knew. It's like, you know what? I think God wanted her to just say those last words to us of, man, I wish I could be here for the rest of the service. It's kills me. My health is failing. She shouldn't have even been in the room, but she just had to be here. She just wanted to worship God with the body and just for her to make a grand exit, you know, unlike Suzette's, you know, it's, you know, that she said something meaningful, you know, but this whole, it didn't really happen, but you know, it was so cool. And then I was told by one of our pastors this morning who went over their house last night, they said, you wouldn't have believed it. I pull up to the house, and it's like a Christmas party. They're laughing. They're just full of joy. They're crying, but they're full of joy. And it's like, man, you know, just hearing reports of that, you know how it just, there's certain people that they just say a few words, and it'll just impact you. I'll never forget her face in the hospital. I'll never forget the words she said when she left here, just struggling to breathe. And go, oh, man, I got to miss the rest of the church service, you know? It's just a rush. And then, yet at the same time, while it says it's so powerful, and you can move people in the right direction, you can move a whole ship, you can move a whole church with this tongue, he says, but it's also like a fire. He says, you know how it only takes a little spark, a little flame, and you can set a whole mountain on fire? In the same way, you can make a little statement to one of your friends and say, hey, I think Cornerstone, blah, blah, and just, it's just, it's amazing. I've seen gossip just fly through churches and things happen and how it can destroy a church so quickly. And so we guard against that. It's like we hear anything. It's like, man, get to the source. What are they saying? What's going on? Because we know that words are so, so powerful. He says you can set a whole forest on fire. It says it sets the whole course of his life on fire. It's weird how I could say a few words right now that could ruin my life, right? This is being recorded. You guys are all here. I say a couple of things, and I could be labeled in the wrong way forever. It's just amazing. I mean, look at Mel Gibson. Okay? I mean, you need to say more. You know, a few words, and you know what? You just showed a side of you that just ruined a lot, and there's no taking it back, there's no rewind button. I mean, how many times have you wanted to hit rewind? Say, oh, let me start this conversation over. Ah, I hit send already, you know? Isn't that the worst? It's just like, oh, why did I do that? Why did I do that? Why did I do that? You know, it's this, and what's powerful about this verse, look at verse 6. Okay, at the end of verse 6, okay, well, it says, the tongue is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person, sets the whole course of his life on fire, and listen to this, and is itself set on fire by hell. That's powerful. My tongue right now could be set on fire by hell. What does it mean by that? That Satan himself could influence what I have to say. The words coming out of this mouth could come straight from hell itself. And any time I use this mouth to tear someone down, guess who's in control of my tongue at that minute? Hell. Anytime I use this mouth to do anything but bring glory to God, who's using this? When I'm bringing glory to myself, who's using this? It's Satan. He's got control of it. Anytime I teach something that is not true, that is not biblical, who else is it coming from? It's Satan. And that's just such a powerful statement to me. And it's true because remember, because we have an example of this in the Bible. Remember when Jesus told his disciples that he was going to be crucified, then he was going to die, and then he would rise again on the third day. Then Peter opens up his mouth, and it seems like an innocent statement. He just goes, never, Lord, not you. You're not going to die. No, never. And what did Jesus say? Get behind me, who? Satan. Remember that? He called Peter Satan. He goes, and then he says, your mind is not on the interests of God, but on man's. You're not thinking about what God wants. You're thinking about what man wants. So get behind me, Satan. That's a strong statement. He said that to Peter. He told Peter, get behind me, Satan. Why? Because at that moment, who was in control of his tongue? Hell. And James here says, you got to understand, hell can control this thing. It's set on fire by hell. The motivation is demonic at times where it's like, wow. And you think about that statement that Peter made, and he was just throwing out what he was feeling at the moment, what he thought, what his opinion was. How many times have we done that? Well, I was just telling you how I felt. Guys, don't take this in the wrong way, okay? Because I do this too, you know. Sometimes I don't think through and pray through what I say in a conversation. Sometimes I'm quick to give my opinion on something. Because I'll study a text and I'll pray about it. And believe me, you know, I love what I do, but I also hate what I do because of what Todd preached last week. You know, he says, you know what, not many of you should become teachers because you're going to be judged more strictly. You think I like that? How would you like to know that God's going to judge you more strictly than everyone else? You just go home and go, oh, cool. No, you go, that stinks, you know? And there are times, you guys, you have no clue how terrified I get sometimes. Because I go, God, I got to be right about this, because it's like this is the little rudder that steers the ship. And if I steer them away from you and away from what's true, if I get influenced by people's opinions and thoughts and what they would like, man, then I'm suddenly, you know, heading this thing in the wrong direction rather than having my interest on God and really seeking it. So it's like during the week, it's like, God, I got to be sure about it. I got to know what this passage says. You got to tell me what to say. And don't let me get influenced another way. This is scary, scary, scary stuff. It's like, God, you might have someone else do it. Why'd you pick me? You know, this is terrifying. And yet there's this other side. It's like, wow, but it does lead people to life. And there's nothing else I'd rather do with my life. But there's also this haunting fear of, man, you just can't be quick to teach. But do you understand that every time you open your mouth to give your opinion to someone, you're teaching. You're influencing them. And you better be sure that you're right. You better be sure that you're giving biblical advice. Because when Peter opened his mouth and gave some advice to Jesus, through his opinion of Jesus, Jesus made it very clear, you're being used by Satan right now, so just get behind me, I can't listen to you. And I thought, wow, could I ever say that to someone? I believe that Satan's using your mouth right now. Let me get back to my point. My point is sometimes after praying and studying and just terrified, but before the Lord going, okay, this is what you've had me to say. Okay, Lord, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it and walk up here and I say it. I walk out that door and suddenly it's meow, 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 and it's like, okay, all right. Do you understand? I get influenced like everyone else. Do you understand? You need to throw out your opinion, your advice, that you might be wrong, and you might influence me, and I might influence thousands, you know? I mean, do you understand that every time we say something, that we got to be careful? These little comments that we say to other people. Man, and when I say don't get me wrong, don't get me wrong, I want to know. If you've searched the scriptures and you've prayed and you go, man, I looked at this passage and I'm pretty sure this is what it says. Man, I want to come and look and because I want to be right also. You know, but have you studied? Have you prayed? Have you thought it through? You know what? Because we want to teach the truth. And when we're not, Satan is using our tongue. So just understand when you give your advice, because I've heard people give advice at this church that I can prove to you from this book is biblically wrong. When someone's convicted about their sin and go, man, I just feel terrible about this. I was going to pursue divorce and then just got so convicted because biblically I don't see that I have grounds. And then someone here will be quick to throw in your opinion, going, yeah, but you know what? God wouldn't want you to stay with her. You know, I mean, think about all the things she did. And I'm just thinking, what? Someone from Cornerstone told you that? That's just terrifying to me. You just used your tongue. Satan just used your tongue, took possession of your body, and you were used by hell that day. Someone can go talk to my dad and forgive him for these things. And someone goes, you don't need to forgive him. I mean, you know, those types of comments, and you don't have to be that pure. And whenever you distract or divert someone, man, I see this all the time when people are really striving for holiness and going, man, I feel like I've spent too much on myself. I need to give more. I need to give more to others. Then someone comes along and goes, no, come on. You know what? God wants you. Are you sure? Because maybe that person's been praying and they're pursuing and they're going, no, this is where God wants me to go. And you're going to open your mouth and throw out your opinion. You better be sure. Because you have the ability to lead someone away from God's will. You and I, we have the ability to have our tongues set on fire by hell to say things that will actually pull people away from God. It's a dangerous thing. That's what this passage is about. It's like, do you know how powerful you are? Do you know how powerful your words are? Shouldn't we learn by now? After all the things that have been said to us that still affect us years later, shouldn't that teach us to be so careful when we open our mouths and when we don't? I'm just saying, not many of us should be giving advice because we're going to be judged pretty strictly for the advice we give. And I know some of us pride ourselves on saying, well, a lot of people come to me, you know, when they have problems with other people. And it's like, okay, that's great, but think through the position you're in. And why are they telling you about other people? Why are you so open to listening to other people's problems? You know, what is it? You know, be careful with this thing. I love how he says it in verse 7. I love this verse. It says, all kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, creatures of the sea are being tamed and have been tamed by men, but no man can tame the tongue. It's a restless evil full of deadly poison. He says, isn't it interesting that we can tame, like, anything? I mean, don't you just, I love when I go to SeaWorld, and I don't think I'll ever cease being amazed by Shamu. you know, and I know he almost ate someone last week, but you know, it's but normally, okay, typically, it that last part of the show, when you've got the killer whale just jumping out of the water and there's a man or woman standing on its mouth, isn't that always just like breathtaking? You're just like, because you see how tiny he is on top of this thing. You're going, no way. You know, all the whale's got to do is go, you know, and it's over. Because you see he's huge and you're tiny. And I just get amazed. And I always think, man, who was the first guy, you know, in his mind to go, I can tame that thing. I can control it. And you're like, you're crazy. But the Bible's right. It just says, it says, man, it's amazing. We can tame anything. We can tame, you know, this whale. We can tame a bear. We can tame an elephant. He goes, but can we control this little piece of flesh that lives inside of our mouths? He goes, no one. No one's been able to pull it off. It's just nuts. It's just this fire. It's so powerful. And we can do so many things on this earth, but we can't control our little tongues. And in verse 9, he says, and with this tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who've been made in God's likeness. You guys, this is the verse that hit me. Because I've talked about this to a degree in the past. Remember when I talked about, we gave a little mini-series on watching your mouth and what you say. It was less than a year ago, a few months ago, I think. And I talked about how you can't separate your relationship with God from your relationship with people. Like, I can't say, I love God, I hate Steve Doucette. Why? Because Steve Doucette is a temple of the Holy Spirit. God's Spirit lives inside of him. And so I can't say, I love you, I hate him, because God's going, wait, but I live in him. You're hating a part of me. He's a temple of the Spirit. You need to treat him with respect. God lives inside of him. It's like, oh, okay, let me be careful about what words I say as I approach the temple of God. Remember that talk? But I always, and I noticed this about myself, I felt a freedom sometimes to say things about people if they were not Christians, if they weren't a temple of the Holy Spirit. And what this verse says is, that's wrong, because you can't praise God with your mouth and also curse men, and then he says, who have been made in the likeness of God. He doesn't use the idea of a Christian here. I don't believe. I believe he's referring back to Genesis 1:26 when he says that we are made in the image of God. You know that every human being on this planet was made in the image of God. I'm not saying we all follow him. I'm not saying we do the things, you know, we do things that rebel against God. But nonetheless, everyone in this room was made in the image of God. And what this passage is saying is, do I ever have a right to curse anyone that was made in the image of God? That hit me pretty hard, because sometimes I felt a freedom, and I don't think I'm a big gossiper, but sometimes I will say certain comments about certain people and feel okay about it, because you know what? They hate God. And so it's okay for me to say this. They, you know, and to be reminded, like, I never thought, it never entered my mind, I don't believe, that Osama bin Laden was made in the image of God. That thought never crossed my mind, that God made him. I don't know how much I've really thought of the fact that God loves him. And in 1 Timothy 2, it explains that we need to be praying for all of the leaders, right? He tells us to pray and give thanksgiving for all leaders. And he says this in 1 Timothy 2:3, he says, this is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all men to be saved. What would God love to see Osama bin Laden do? Be saved. Fall in love with him. Repent. Why? Because God loves him. And I don't want God seeing me on this earth cursing someone that he loves. I used to feel a freedom with politicians who didn't agree with me. You know? And to go, well, they're standing against God, so I, no. So you need to pray for them and love them because God wants that person to be saved. You need to love George Bush and Hillary Clinton. They are both creating the image of God. Wherever you stand on issues, doesn't matter. It's about love. You don't have a right to hate anyone that God created and use this mouth to curse anyone that God wants saved. I mean, really, the heart of God is Romans 5:8, of that while we were sinners, that God demonstrated his love for us and Christ died for us. Not because we were so lovable, but he looks down and goes, wow, these people are rebelling against me, but I love them, and I love them so much that I'm going to pursue them. Christmas is not about Jesus coming to the earth to curse the world, right? It's not about God looking down and going, man, look at them rebel against me. I'm going to curse them. No, instead, I'm going to send my son down and show love to them and save them. And in the same way, as a reflection of Jesus Christ, I'm supposed to look at those who are antagonistic toward God and love them and pursue them and save them and pray for them, but not curse them. It was really powerful for me. You know, he uses this idea of, he says, out of the same mouth, you know, verse 10, out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers, this should not be. He goes, you can't use this mouth to praise and curse. It's one or the other. You know, you gave over, when you became a Christian, for those of you who are Christians in this room, 1 Corinthians 6:20 says that you were bought at a price. It's like Christ purchased you. He goes, therefore, honor God with your body. So at that time you say, God, here's my body. You give it to him. It's like a gift. And here, I got a little gift bag here. Here, give it to Al. Here, Merry Christmas. All right, open it up. What'd you get? A toothbrush. That's a hint. And let's say he gets his toothbrush and he's so happy with it, you know, just brushing, flossing, just like, coming to church so proud. And then one day I go, hey, Al, you remember that toothbrush? My aunt just came in from, you know, Hong Kong and she forgot her toothbrush. Can I borrow that for a few weeks? And he goes, oh, yeah, sure. And so then I take back the toothbrush and I, you know, give it to my aunt and she uses it for a little bit, you know, just for a few weeks. And then I come back, okay, you can have it back now. Yeah, ew. You know, you just feel like, I mean, not that she's, I don't even know your aunt, but that's just gross, okay? You see, it's that picture of us. Understand, when we became a believer, we said, God, here's my tongue. Here's my eyes. Here's my hands. They're yours. You own them. I'm surrendering myself to you. And then every once in a while, I go, wait, God, let me get my tongue back for a second. Let me use it. I'm going to let Satan borrow it for a little bit. Here, Satan, go ahead. Okay, use my tongue now. Let me gossip. Let me say some things that aren't true. Let me slander some people. Let me put some people down. Let me, you know, do this, do that with this tongue. And then we come back. Okay, God, I'm done with it. You can have it back. Use it to praise you. And he's going, ew. You just gave that to Satan? To borrow for a little bit, and then you give it back to me, and you take it back. He goes, you can't use that same, you can't let us both use this tongue. Man, whose is it? He says, that's gross. You don't go back and forth. You surrendered your body to me. Out of the same mouth, you can't have blessing and cursing. But I love the solution to this, because at the last verse we're going to look at, our last two verses, can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. Okay, what's he saying? He goes, if this spring is a salt water source, guess what's always going to come out? salt water. You can't change it. You can't try to put a filter. It's just, that's just who it is at the core. Just like this fig tree. He goes, can I get it to bear olives? No, you can't. Why? At the core, it's a fig tree. He goes, what do you need then to bear olives? An olive tree. You know, just like you need a fresh water spring. So it's not changing and trying to control this tongue. It's changing the very source of it, your very heart. Why do blessing and cursing come out of your mouth? Because there's blessing and cursing in your heart. You need a new heart. You need God to change who you are. This message is not about biting your tongue and offering lip service. It's not about, ooh, I'll watch what I say about that person. It's, ooh, I'll watch what I feel about that person. I'm not telling you to give lip service to your ex. I'm saying to love him deeply as much as you love yourself. Love her deeply as much as you love yourself. Realize, wow, what's done is done, and now it was wrong, but I'm not going to further this. I'm going to love. I'm going to love. I'm going to go back. I'm going to love. What are we talking about here? This is crazy stuff. I'm saying if you were raped, you need to pray to God that you would have a heart that would even love the person who raped you. If you were molested as a child, that you say, God, I don't have a right to curse that person. I want to love. I need to love. I need to love this person as much as I love myself. Change my heart by the power of the Holy Spirit. If you were abused as a kid, if you were abandoned as a child, that you say, God, change my heart. It's this crazy stuff, and it's only done by the power of the Holy Spirit. But that's what we're talking about here. It's a heart that just says, God, I gave you this body, and you don't want this body to curse anyone on this earth. You want to use this body to love. I was praying yesterday afternoon, just repenting before God and going, God, I can't control this tongue. I need you to change my heart. I don't want anything to come out of this mouth that doesn't honor you. I don't want to. I want this to be totally yours. I don't want to borrow it for a little bit to use for myself. I want this body to truly be yours. And it isn't completely. I see myself pulling back and this and that. And I just saw the severity in James and going, God, I want a body that just, it's for you. This tongue was created by God. God made it. Colossians 1:16 says, all things were created by him and for him. Why did God make this tongue? To praise him. Why did he make this body up here? To praise him, to direct others, to praise him. That's all this body should be used for. And when I think about that, you guys, I got to see a good example of this week of some people who just surrendered themselves to God. I was asked to speak at a prayer meeting on Monday and Tuesday. This church had 2 weeks of prayer. And I was like, all right, you know, I've never really spoken at an event like that. I'll come check it out and speak. And after the first day, I thought, oh, I need to videotape some of this and show it to the church. And so here's a video clip of where I went on Monday and Tuesday morning. I'm in a suit because they told me to wear a suit. Other than that, I loved them. This is really cool. This is days 9 and 10 of their prayer meeting. Hey, it's 4:20 in the morning. We're in Anaheim. Don't know what you're doing Tuesday morning, 4:20. But I'm going to a prayer meeting at a Korean church. Those crazy Koreans. Praying at 4:20 in the morning. So we're just getting ready to pull up to the church here and just want to see if anyone showed up. The meeting doesn't start till 5. So I'm thinking 4:20, no one's going to be here first day, and this is 4:30. By 4:30, there were no more seats in the church, okay? because they were singing at the top of their lungs, and I'm going, wait, what time's it start? And they go, oh, it hasn't started yet. And I'm going, what? You know, and so here people are running because they know so if you don't make it in, you're in the parking lot, and there are people in the parking lot at 4:30. In Anaheim. It's been going on for like 10 days, and these are all junior high and high school students doing what your kids do at 4 in the morning. In the back, you know, you can't see, in the back hallway are all these parents with their babies. You know, because they don't have a nursery, you know, they're just holding their babies because they want to be there. And so they've been getting their babies up at, 3:30 in the morning for a couple of weeks.
I realized that I had...
It was so hard to talk to them because I'm going, I had no clue anything like this existed. I talk about being lukewarm, you know, and I'm going... Okay, I wouldn't preach that over there. Okay, you know, man, you guys, it was just powerful. I didn't know anything like that existed in America. And over 2,000 people, and then there, I didn't see the people in the parking lot and the satellite rooms and everything else. They got there late. They were only 20 minutes early. You know. It was like, what? Every day, and they're carrying their kids, and elementary school kids, preschool kids, junior high school, college, grandparents, all these generations. Their theme was three generations praying together, living the legacy. I'm like, right on, you guys. And I just told that church, I go, I'm blown away right now. I don't even have words to say to you. I don't get this. And then I find out, you know, that anyone that wants to do anything in that church, they want to pass out bulletins, whatever, they have to go through 3 years of discipleship, 3 years of training. And I go, well, what's the time commitment? He goes about 10 to 15 hours a week. And I go, how many people have gone through that? About 3,000. And there's about 600 of them in process right now. We've had to turn more away because I'm just going, it's one thing if I came back and said, hey, you guys, I was in Korea and I saw this out there. Aren't they nuts? You know? And you're like, yeah, you know, but what do they do all day? We live in Southern California. You know, okay. It's just excuse after excuse was being shot down from me. It's like, well, yeah, but we're young families. Oh. We're this, we're that. We're in Simi. Oh. It's just, wow. You guys are just committed. It really opened my eyes. I'm like, man, what do I do in the mornings? What's my prayer life like? What's my study like? And sometimes we just need an example like that, right? You know, where you go, wow, you guys really have surrendered your bodies to the Lord to use at any hour He wants, any time, not when it's convenient. And I thought, you know what? I just prayed when I was there, God, I know Cornerstone can be that way. I know, you know. I know some of your lives, your hearts, and you go, you know what? If you want to do it at that hour, I'll be here. And don't know if I can get my whole family here, but I'll be there, you know? And I know some of you guys are thinking that, and I just thought, you know, first let's do it individually, and then 07, let's hit it hard, and let's, you know, we've been given an example. God showed that to me, to go, okay, you know what? Let's do this. But first, are you spending time alone with the Lord? Are you using your tongue for what it was made for? It was made to praise God. That's what it should be used for. It should be used for that in the morning, all through the day at work, at night when you go to bed. This body belongs to God. It's been surrendered to Him. And so before we get into it, don't wait till New Year's and go, well, I was going to start praying. I was going to wait till New Year's, make a resolution, and have it last 3 months. Start now. And go, you know what, right now I surrender myself to you, God. And we're going to start with this, a time of prayer in this room, where I'm just going to give you some time, just alone with God, to surrender yourself to Him again and say, God, you know what, I want this mouth to be yours. It's cursed some people, and forgive me for that, and I'm going to use it now to go bless those people, to ask forgiveness from those people. to come before God and just give him words of thanksgiving and praise this Christmas season. If some of you need some prayer, because I realize some of you have gone through some things in life and it's not easy to let go of some of that bitterness, and some crazy things have been done to you. But I'm saying by the power of the Holy Spirit, you can love those people. You really can. And maybe you need some prayer and some support, and we want to do that for you. And so we'll be up here by the prayer room. Some of you, maybe you want to use your tongues to confess Jesus Christ today through baptism, to say in front of all of us, you know what? I publicly use this tongue to declare to you that I believe in Jesus Christ, that he died on that cross for me. And now this body is physically going to be baptized, showing that I believe that Jesus died and rose again to a new life. And I believe that's what God wants me to do with this body this morning. If so, then come forward and get baptized. And we'll have some counselors and people to pray for you. But right now, just bow your heads. And I don't know what God wants you to do with your body, your mind, your words right now. I'm just saying surrender it to him and pray to him, whatever you think God wants you to. And if you need some help, we'll be in the prayer room.